Oh, you can see they're getting ready to go. All right, we're just counting down. It's about to start. Oh, there we go. Woo!
You're watching Top Flight Family. We're the Sognonvi family from New York City. And last year, we visited 21 resorts in 2021. Now that major cities around the world have reopened, this year we're visiting 22 cities in 2022. This is city number 4. We stayed at Four Seasons Resort Dubai at Jumeirah Beach. The location was a convenient home base from which to explore Dubai, and because it's a beach resort, it was also a relaxing escape from the busyness of the city.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Nice room service breakfast to start the day.
Yeah. I have to taste it first.
Check out the view.
Oh yeah. Got a nice view of the skyline, including the Burj, but my arm is not far enough to extend. You guys excited?
Yes.
So excited. Where are we going now?
We're going to IMG World of Adventures.
That sounds super fun.
At over 1.5 million square feet, IMG World of Adventure is one of the world's largest indoor amusement parks. There are 6 different zones, each with a different theme, including Marvel and Cartoon Network.
Did you hear me scream?
Yes.
It was really fun. It went like upside down.
I saw. Like that bit looks crazy. Bye. Oh my god.
Oh my god. Can we do it again?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yay! Are you guys gonna come?
Hell no.
Back at Four Seasons, we had dinner at Sifu. This beachside restaurant serves modern Asian seafood in a laid-back, loungy environment.
You just got back from the gym?
Yeah, had a knee workout, buddy. Salt Bay is in the gym. He's on the treadmill right now. So crazy. I came in and I was like, it's kind of familiar. Because I had his hair down. Then he walked in and then he was doing a story. Then he tied his hair up and he put the glasses on. I was like, oh wow, I really think that's him. Check the story. He's like staying at the hotel. And that story he just did, I was like right next to him. Why? Sorry.
This is the most Dubai thing ever.
Yeah, Salt Bae's on the treadmill next to you. Only in Dubai.
Seriously.
Later in the trip, we realized that Salt Bae's restaurant is actually right next door to Four Seasons, so it makes sense that he would be staying here. On Serge's next visit to the gym, he and Salt Bae got to chatting and they snapped the selfie together. If you're coming to Dubai and want the full Salt Bae experience, be sure to order the Golden Tomahawk, a bone-in Wagyu ribeye encrusted in 24-karat gold leaf. It'll only set you back a couple thousand bucks. When we travel, we always love connecting with born and raised locals from the destination. But one thing I always find a bit jarring about visiting countries like Qatar or the United Arab Emirates, and many first-time visitors probably don't even realize this, is that you can easily go through your entire trip without ever interacting with an actual Qatari or Emirati person. Maybe with the exception of the immigration officer at the airport. The UAE has a population of about 10 million, but only 1 million of these are Emiratis. The other 90% of the population consist of people from other countries. Indians make up the largest population in Dubai at nearly 3 million, followed by Pakistanis at 1.3 million, Bangladeshis at 750,000, and Filipinos at 500,000. Migrants are the people who work most of the jobs in Dubai. Many Emiratis don't necessarily have to work at all because the government provides incredibly generous benefits, like free healthcare, tax-free income, subsidized fuel, access to land and interest-free loans to build homes, free higher education even if you go to school abroad, debt bailouts for business owners, and when an Emirati man marries an Emirati woman, he receives a gift of nearly $20,000 from the government to help start their household. When Emiratis do work, 90% of them hold government jobs. It's incredibly rare to find an Emirati working in a lower-level, customer-facing position. So as a tourist, even when you're doing things that expose you to the local Emirati culture, like exploring the gold souk or the spice souk or doing a desert safari, none of the people working in those places are going to be Emirati. Tour guides, shopkeepers, dune bashing drivers, camel handlers, they're all likely to be migrants from various countries throughout South Asia or North Africa.
I am 12 now, so I finally think it's time for me to step into my big girl shoes, you know? Time to be a new me. Nice chilled glass. Maybe I'm excited.
Don't worry, this was just a non-alcoholic sparkling drink to kick off our lovely afternoon tea at Chai Salon at the hotel.
Right now, we're doing a little walking tour and we're gonna try some street food here. Serge,
yes.
Why are they saying Jumbo to you?
I guess everybody's Kenyan here, they look like me. So I'm either Kenyan or Ugandan. So
that's it, right? Those two.
We are at our first stop. So both of these restaurants, one's been open since 1971, and the other one is 73. So almost as old as the UAE itself.
I can snack tea break, a cup of tea, along with the dumpling. It's called pakora.
This is the chili. 1, 2, 3, 4. They're spicy, but very mild.
Salty. And it kind of has like peanuts.
Not too spicy.
So we eat this and drink tea. It's a local tea, normal. We call this karak.
Okay.
So it's coming.
Okay.
We order only three.
Thank you.
So it's good hot drink with the cold weather.
Mm.
It's like there's a cardamom in there or something.
Without sugar, without fruits, without anything. It's called in Arabic, the Arabic name of lassi is laban.
Oh.
It's so good.
Yeah?
Super good. Like it?
Wow, really fresh. Ooh, wow.
Okay. How you have to do? Bring. First, you have to put this. No, keep it like that, yeah? Bring it in the plate. You put this.
Is that chickpeas in the middle?
Yeah. Uh-huh. This is like sweet.
Uh-huh.
This. Very, 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 very little. Okay. Put in 1 pound. In one shot, you have to put the whole thing in your mouth. Then you get the right flavors, okay?
Yeah.
Ready? One, two,
okay,
three.
You know what? Give it to Sean. Sean will do
okay,
it.
Okay, give it to Sean. All. Yeah. Bring it. Yum?
Yay!
Okay, it's called pani puri. It's the street food of India.
Oh, Ala is doing her own.
Yeah.
Alright, don't wait too long. Yeah, nope, the whole thing in your mouth. Ooh, good job.
It's like something I've never tried before.
That's right.
Good.
It's special.
That's why we're here.
Thank you.
See the size of it?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's big.
So big.
It's the top quality. So in the tea we use like this. In the coffee also you can use it like latte or cappuccino or whatever.
Gold.
It's your natural deodorant.
Yeah.
Oh, it's getting spicy.
In our past, we never had enough water to wash our clothes. We never had any perfume to use for our body. Yeah. So this is actually what we are doing. Because normally, we are riding the camels. You are staying with the camel too long, so you smell like camel. So you have to use something that removes bad smells or camel smells, you can say, from the cloth. So we are using this one.
And what is it?
This is oud, O-U-D.
Oh.
Yeah, wood is kind of wood that we burn on the charcoal to make a nice fragrance in our home, for church, for mosque. You can use it for your clothes, you can use it for body. So this is how it works.
So it's camel chocolate.
It's not made out of camels though. Who put a date in my chocolate?
So Valentine's Day is coming up.
I think I need to get three of those.
So I'm thinking this one and that one.
The UAE may be full of migrant workers, but unfortunately they are not always treated fairly. The UAE's immigration system ties work visas to employers. To explain it in an oversimplified way, workers can't change jobs, quit, or leave the country without their employer's permission. As you can imagine, this can easily lead to situations involving exploitation. Over the last few years, the government has implemented new laws attempting to curb these abuses, but results have been mixed, to say the least. Another problem for migrants is that under current laws, once a foreign worker hits the age of 60, they face compulsory retirement, and their employer can cancel their visa at any time. Once this happens, they would have just 30 days to leave the country. Many migrant workers have lived in the UAE for their entire adult lives. They have children, sometimes even grandchildren in the country. But the immigration system here has been deliberately designed to severely limit the options for permanent residence for foreigners. The government has recently introduced some new policies that would allow foreigners to retire in the UAE, but these tend to target wealthy individuals who can afford to make big financial investments. So as of now, unfortunately, the life of a migrant worker in the UAE is still one of risk and uncertainty.
When you're staying at the Four Seasons, you get this tablet and you can chat for whatever you need. If you need extra towels, soap, whatever you need. And Ella's been chatting on this thing.
Well, I said, hi, it's Ella. And she's like, hi, how may I assist you? And I said, how are you doing? And she's like, I'm good. And then she was saying, like, how can I assist you? And I was like, nothing much. And then, let's chit-chat. Anyways, and then after that, she was like, and they were talking about how we did like a bunch of stuff, and then she said that I had a good day, and I said, hi, I'm back.
Oh my god, when we got back, you said you talked to him again? Oh my god.
Just now. And then,
you know, you're supposed to put in requests, they're not just there to be your friend.
I guess when you spend this much time with your family, sometimes you need someone else to chat with instead. So to the Four Seasons guest services team, thank you for your patience. These are the weird kinds of things that can happen sometimes when you travel with kids, so thank you for being so kind and patient with Ella. On our first trip to Dubai, we were in our hotel room flipping through the local TV channels when we came across something we'd never seen before, a camel race. Turns out camel racing is huge in the UAE. The tradition can be traced as far back as the 7th century, and preserving cultural heritage is a big priority for this country. So the government puts up massive amounts of prize money to encourage Emiratis to participate in heritage sports like this. We booked a specialty tour that focused on camel racing so that we could learn all about it.
In the olden days, people used to do camel racing for the fun of it, for entertainment, for marriage festivals, and also for special occasions, even religious ceremonies. But these days, camel racing is done as a professional sport, but it's a heritage sport.
This looks like a rather nondescript commercial area, but in fact, this is where you'll find the entire ecosystem of products and services that support camel racing.
Okay, so we're here right now at the souk, and this is sort of like the camel souk. So you'll definitely find just regular grocery stores, little places to eat, but then there's also lots of stores that sell different camel accessories, everything from like the blankets and the harnesses to the actual robo jockeys.
And yes, I did just say robo jockeys. One unique thing about camel racing in the Gulf states today is that the camels are ridden by robots, not humans. Up until a couple decades ago, though, they did use human riders. So why did they stop that practice? Well, unfortunately, the reason is disturbing, and we'll get into that later in the video.
So this is the robo jockey, what it has inside. It's a Dewalt motor.
Oh, wow, it's like a drill.
Yeah, drill, power drill.
Wow.
And then this can be, one would be connecting to the electronic whip, mm-hmm. the other switch will go to the speaker and this remote control. So the speaker is geared in such a way that the camels can hear it. The camels are also very sensitive animals. They're also very sharp in the ears. So even a small sound, they can hear from a distance. So when the owner talks it, especially on a race day, the camel understands it.
So this is sort of like the bones of it. And then it would be customized by specific colors. And those are all, I guess they have to be sort of registered with the government so that each owner has their own specific like color scheme.
Oh, so that's the electronic whip.
Yeah, so it just spins like that.
We headed to Al Marmoom Dubai Camel Racetrack, which is the largest camel racetrack in Dubai. It's a state-of-the-art facility with multiple tracks and giant jumbotrons from which you can follow the race. Camel races are open to the public, and non-Emiratis are welcome to attend, but they're not necessarily marketed as a tourist attraction. The government deliberately keeps the races low-key because the main goal is to preserve this part of their heritage, not necessarily to grow the sport into a big business.
Today, it's four big races, part of the Dubai Crown Prince Camel Racing Festival. The first race is nearly $1 million in prize money. The second race is $1.5 million in prize money. The third race is $2 million. The fourth and final race is $3 million prize money.
You see the robots?
Oh yeah.
Who are you guys rooting for?
We're rooting for yellow. Red is winning.
Mm. So we're here at the Camel racetrack, and it's really, really cool. You can definitely feel that there's this real sense of like nervous excitement. It's definitely a high-stakes situation. So down here is kind of the behind the scenes. So this is where the next set of camels are getting ready to race. And then let me take you around to the other side. So this is actually the track. The next batch is getting ready. Oh, you can see they're getting ready to go. All right, we're just counting down. It's about to start. Oh, there we go. Woo! Wow. Oh, one of them got lost. Wow, so you see all the cars going on either side. Those are the owners and the trainers operating the robots and yelling at their camels to go, go, go faster. So you see how this license plate is only two digits, 91. That means it's a very, very, very expensive license plate. So in a place where everybody already has fancy cars, you kind of need something to set it apart. And it's all about the license plates here. So the lower your number, the more prestigious it is, the more higher status that is. And some of these license plates can cost literally millions of dollars. So we're seeing a lot of expensive license plates here because of course, camel racing is not an affordable sport.
All right.
Only owners of the camels are allowed to be in this track. Mm. The track on the right is for the sheikhs. It's also for the TV. I got permission from the local officials and they allowed us to be here along with the owners. So in a few minutes, the gate will come down for the third race. And then we're going to follow the camels along with the owners.
All right, 10 seconds. See all the cars getting ready. Whoop, there we go. And they're off. We saw a camel that was covered with some kind of yellow paste, so we asked Barty about it.
Oh, sandalwood powder, yes. Wow. And saffron.
And saffron, mixed with water.
Uh-huh.
And they pasted it on the camel with the out of celebration, jubilation that the camel has won.
Oh,
not necessarily the first place, even the second and third place camels are treated that way.
Oh, so those are the champion ones.
We are talking about 1 kilogram of saffron and sandalwood mixture is at $12,000.
Whoa. Whoa. Oh my god. So yeah, as you can see, these owners do not skimp on their camels.
Okay, so now we are going to the stands and we're going to watch the last of this race finish up.
So if you had a champion camel, what would you do?
I would give it everything. I would give it baths, I would give it extra food, and I'd give it camel candy.
Camel candy.
Every day will be a treat day, and I'll never have to work out. I'll just need it just to win the first time.
But the people working as handlers, trainers, they are from Sudan, Bangladesh, Pakistan, or Afghanistan. They didn't have that experience before coming here. They were brought in by referral, and when they came here, they learned it. You see, we used to use young boys as jockeys before 1998. They were replaced by the robo jockeys.
And this is the disturbing history of camel racing in the UAE. Up until not too long ago, little boys as young as 3 or 4 years old would be taken from poor countries like Pakistan and Sudan to work as camel jockeys. They would be deliberately underfed to keep them light, and some were subjected to severe mistreatment. In the late 90s, the UAE passed laws banning the use of children, but it wasn't until the early 2000s that these laws were actually enforced, and they started testing what it would take to replace humans with robot jockeys. If you'd like to learn more about this, I'll link below to an excellent video from HBO Real Sports.
Any camel injured or not well can be brought to this camel hospital and be treated.
So this sign means that camels get the right of way.
Like camel crossing.
Yeah, camel crossing. We have to give way for the camels. Camels first.
Just a mile or two away from the racetrack, you'll find homes of the Emirati camel owners. These aren't their primary residences, but their second homes where they'll spend the night on race days. The homes have holding pens for the camels, as well as housing for the camel trainers and handlers who live here. Barty took us to one of them to see if they might let us have a look around. The owner was very friendly and welcoming. I was hoping to ask him some questions about camel racing, but unfortunately, without a translator on hand, communication was a bit challenging. He offered to allow our daughters to ride on one of his prized racing camels. Sean and Ella were a bit nervous to try it, so instead, Serge hopped on.
Racing camels are kept always under utmost care, and not everybody gets a chance to ride a racing camel, so today, I was pretty lucky.
It's a rare honor. Dubai's hurdle towards modernity has come at a price. Underneath the glitz and glamour lurks tremendous economic inequality. The city relies on a massive labor force imported from other countries. But when those workers face constant risk and insecurity, I have to wonder how stable the society really is. It's heartening to see Dubai's leaders constantly passing new reforms, but only time will tell whether these changes come fast enough.
Okay, that was city number 4 of the 22 cities we are visiting in 2022. If you'd like to check out city number 5, just click that video right there. If you haven't already, please subscribe and turn on notifications. And follow us on TikTok and Instagram at Top Flight Family. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.